tells us that we are supposed to submit to authority. Submit to authority. That includes the authority of government. In fact, that's specifically what Paul was speaking of when he said, submit to authority. Now, I want to remind you that the context in which Paul's writing, Paul is in Rome. He's been invited to Rome to be Caesar's guest, correct? Seriously, he has appealed to Caesar, having been on trial, and Festus and Agrippa agreed that he's on his way to Caesar. And he will actually be treated like a guest for a time until things get worse, and then eventually Paul is going to be killed by Caesar, by Caesar's soldiers. Why? Because of his belief in Jesus Christ. And Paul is now saying that we are supposed to submit to authority, and he even is referring to the very Caesar who is going to kill him. Submit to authority, and we do that out of our commitment to Jesus Christ. A couple of weeks ago, we began by asking the question, what is God's will? And we said that God's will is for each of us to be a world changer. Now, as a world changer, can any one of us change the whole globe? Not very easily. But we all have a world that we are supposed to be responsible for. A world of people right around us. In fact, the definition of a world changer is someone who actively encourages people in their relational world, their oikos, to become Christ followers. Someone who actively works to engage their world, their 8 to 15 people that they're connected to become Christ followers. And if we each, just if each of us right here, worked on those 8 to 15 people, some of them are Christians, so we keep encouraging them to grow. Some of them are Christians, but they've moved kind of away from God and the church, and they need to be encouraged to get back in relationship with God's people. And some of them are totally unchurched and may even be hostile towards God. A significant portion of our own culture today. And they simply need to be loved. Loved. We need to care about them. Sincerely care. Even if they don't commit their lives to Jesus Christ. Even if they never accept your invitation to come to your house or to come to worship or to come to a life group, we need to care about them. And if we each, for example, had 8 people who are hostile towards God, totally unchurched, defiant and negative and don't believe there's any absolute except themselves, if we each loved, blessed, like Tim talked about last week, those 8 people, would that change the world around us? The hostilities that have been going out there online on Facebook and stuff, wouldn't some of those hostilities even change? And there's some nasty stuff. And again, it's on both sides, okay? No one can take ownership of one side or the other. Those who are opposed or those who are in favor. There's some just hostility out there. But if love, if blessing was really at the core and the heart of that for each person, would that influence people in our world? You see, God's given each of us this little niche. Every single one of us, right? Has a niche of humanity that we are supposed to care about, that we're supposed to build relationship with. And the fact is that we don't get to choose many of them, do we? Significant number of that 8 to 15 people, they're kind of maybe even forced upon us. Did you choose who was your father and your mother? Probably not. Brothers and sisters, any of you have any brothers and sisters that you fought with when you were younger? Did you choose them? Better still, would they have chosen you? Your neighbors. Now, some of you may have actually kind of picked your home based on your neighborhood. But some of you didn't do enough research before you moved in. Or when you moved in, the neighborhood went downhill. We all have a niche of people, and they're around us, and they spend they're next to us, and God's wanting us to care about those neighbors, those people in our oikos, our community, our household. 2 weeks ago, we talked about tough people in our lives. Any of you have anyone like that? Show me, raise hands. Anyone have a tough person in your life? Am I that tough person for anyone? She didn't raise her hand. Wow. She's more gracious than any of you realize. You be quiet. We have tough people in our lives. They're difficult. They're sometimes they're uncomfortably around. Some of them are obnoxious, rude, inconsiderate. And I'm talking about us, right? But some of them are just really hard people to get along with. But you're with them all the time. Some of us see them in the mirror. the tough people in our lives. The people that just, they're difficult. And we talked about how do we love them. And then last week, Tim described our responsibility, this calling that God's put on our lives to be blessers, not converters. To bless people instead of going out and trying to change them. And what a difference it would make if all of God's people were blessers, blessing the people around them. What do you do when someone in authority demands something that you don't like or that you don't believe? What do you do? Now, I should say that the emphasis on these verses is on governmental authority, but the principles that we're going to look at today really relate to all forms of authority, don't they? It could be the authority of a mother, a father, a teacher, a boss, or even a neighbor. So authority can cover many different areas. Police officers, firefighters, go on down the list. So there are three types of authoritative decisions. Number one, those that are easy to conform to. There are some decisions, it's just easy to. Somebody says, please have some of this homemade ice cream. Okay, if I must. Yeah, what was it? Virgil says, you're twisting my arm. Yeah. There's things that it's just easy to do. But then, secondly, are those that are difficult to conform to. This would include decisions that people in authority make that you don't like. I know. I mean, since the election, half of the country has been, we're not going to agree with anything. Because they just don't like Trump, and so they're just not going to agree with anything. And there's just been that negative sense of, I'm not going to conform, I'm going to make it difficult. And then the third one is those that you simply cannot conform to. Somebody says, go kill your neighbor. Go steal someone's car. Take this illicit drug. There's things that you simply cannot conform to. And this category would include those things that explicitly the Bible tells us is wrong. Things we're not supposed to do. So if somebody orders you, hate your neighbor, is that biblical? You know, we're supposed to love our neighbor? And by the way, there are guidelines that we could discuss, but this morning, really this text is not about number three. The things that we can't conform to. It's really about number two. The things that are difficult to conform to. And if you take a look at on the next slide, when we kind of look at life, we kind of look at it and say, okay, well, there's easy things, then there's difficult things, and then there's things that we just cannot do. Now, sometimes our perception, though, looks more like this. There's very little that's easy, a lot that's difficult, and a ton of things that we never could do. Reality is like this. Most decisions are actually pretty easy. Several are difficult. Very, very few things that we're asked to do in life are things that we cannot do. So we're going to try to focus on the things that are difficult to do. So our text says, find a way to live in submission. Everyone must submit himself, verse 1 of Romans 13. Everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Find a way to live in submission. Yesterday at our life group, we were talking about, in fact, somebody was saying, talking about praying for President Obama when he was president, and how hard it was to pray for President Obama. And the reason for that was because that person's, if you think about it, that person's view of what Obama stood for. In fact, his politics, right? And yet, does the Bible say only pray for Republican presidents? It doesn't say that? Well, really? Does it say to only pray for the presidents that you like? We got a lot of people praying against the president right now, and some of them are Republicans. Now, if you think about it, the election of Donald Trump has a ton of people angry. And the sad thing is that because more than 80% of evangelicals voted for Trump, guess who they're also angry at? At evangelicals. At evangelicals. By the way, are any of you evangelical? You like, you believe in the good news of Jesus Christ? Anyone here? Uh-oh. We need to find a way to live in submission. Well, let's ask it a different way. How many of you appreciate the government in California? You obviously must, because as a state, you continue to vote more taxes. And the increase. In fact, how many of you are looking forward to the sales tax increase on gasoline? Or those of you who live here on the mountain, what a privilege. You get to pay $35 an extra a year for fire protection. Extra. Do you bless and pray for those who are making those decisions? There are new bills going before our state government, our state assembly, and state senate. And one of those is requiring kindergartners to learn about LGBT sexual options. 5-year-olds shouldn't even be learning about sex, and they're being taught how the different alternatives for sex. Okay, are we praying for those government leaders who are making those decisions? Are we submitting to them? Oh, it gets them a little more challenging if you can find a side that maybe you're not for, right? And what does God want us to do when it's difficult like that? He says, find a way to live in submission. Was Martin Luther King, civil rights leader, living in submission when he would do marches in Alabama, where he was arrested, in many of the different states, were in South Carolina and Georgia? Was when he was doing his civil rights, was he submitting to authority? Actually, he was. Because peacefully, he led his people across bridges that he had the right to cross. Peacefully, he tried to say, what is happening in our country is wrong. And in fact, he was submitting to authority. And yes, he got arrested more than once because of it. He didn't fight. And he would be arrested. And frankly, he lost his life. Because he was actually trying to submit to authority, but also stand up and speak truth. And what he said was, is you got to do that peacefully. Now, sadly, it wasn't always peaceful, was it? But why? Now, some of it might have been some of his followers, but more than that, it tended to be people who were angry with him, who maybe felt guilty, who fought him. See, the submission to authority, notice what the text is challenging us to do. We have to figure out ways to submit to authority, even if it's difficult. And there will be times when we will have to say no. In fact, practice your purpose before you protect your rights. Practice your purpose before you protect your rights. Romans 13:2 says, consequently, he who rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. Practice your purpose. God has given each of us a purpose, and that needs to guide. Isn't that what Martin Luther King then was saying? Look, I have a purpose in life, and it's to set people free. It's to show honor and value and respect to all people. All people are created with those unalienable rights. They come from what? Well, our founders understood it. They come from God, not from government. So practice your purpose before you protect your rights. What has God called you to do? You personally. What has he called you to do? Exactly. He's called you to follow Jesus, to be a world changer, to be a witness in your world, making a difference with those 8 to 15 people. Follow that purpose before you start demanding your personal rights. You see, Paul actually had appealed to Caesar, even though he had done nothing wrong. And he doesn't even rebel. Instead, he uses the opportunity to speak to Festus and King Agrippa. Do you remember the story in Acts 26 and 27? Paul understands that his purpose in life is to live for Christ, even the Jews, though the Jews want to have him killed. Or at least some of them do. The religious leaders there of the day, they want to have him killed. So he goes before King Festus and then King Agrippa. They actually come together. And Acts 25 says, Festus, wishing to do the Jews a favor, said to Paul, are you willing to go to Jerusalem and stand trial before me there on these charges? Paul answered, I am now standing before Caesar's court where I ought to be tried. I have not done any wrong to the Jews, as you yourself know very well. If, however, I am guilty of doing anything deserving death, I do not refuse to die. You hear the submission? But if the charges brought against me by these Jews are not true, no one has the right to hand me over to them. And then what did he say next? I appeal to Caesar. After Festus had conferred with his council, he declared, you have appealed to Caesar, to Caesar you will go. Festus has actually been meeting with Paul. In fact, he's been in prison now actually for a couple of years already. The king before Festus had left, and now Festus has taken over, so he's trying to understand this case before this man. They want him to go to Jerusalem because the Jews that are there already have a plan for killing him. And in Acts 26, Agrippa, King Agrippa, has come to town. And Festus says, you know, I've got this man. I think he's innocent. I don't understand why they want to kill him. It seems like it's just a religious thing. And I really want to let him go, but I want to hear what you think, King Agrippa. And King Agrippa and his wife sit in on a meeting, and they listen to Paul. And Paul's preaching away. What an opportunity. Preaching to the kings of the day. Chapter 26, verse 31, it says, after they left the room, they began saying to one another, this is King Agrippa and King Festus. After they left the room, they began saying to one another, this man is not doing anything that deserves death or imprisonment. Agrippa said to Festus, this man could have been set free if he had not appealed to Caesar. Paul understands his purpose in life. Paul is called to go to Rome. Jesus has actually warned him, you're going to go to Rome and you're going to die there. You're going to suffer a lot for me, Paul. That's when he was Saul on the road from Tarsus, Saul on the road to Damascus. And Jesus, why are you persecuting me? Then he tells him, okay, now you're going to suffer for me now, Paul. Paul understands that his purpose in life is to be a world changer. And who are his friends going to be? Well, in this case, it was Festus and Agrippa. In fact, Agrippa says, Paul, who do you think you are? Are you really going to convert me with just this one conversation? And Paul's standing there like, I'm hoping. I'm praying I will. I sure hope you're listening, King Agrippa, because what I'm speaking is truth and it matters. And it's life and death for you, Agrippa. And this may be the only time you're going to hear it. So yes, I hope you will convert. Paul understands that his purpose in life is to serve Jesus Christ. Romans 13:3, for rulers hold no terror for those who do right. Paul understands, yeah, I'm not afraid of Caesar. I'm not afraid of you guys, Festus and Agrippa, because I'm following Jesus. But for those who do wrong, do you want to be free from fear of the one in authority? Then do what is right, and he will commend you. It doesn't always happen, though, does it? Because there have been rulers who have had Christians killed. And we'll come back to that in a minute. As we try to learn submission, faith and influence go hand in hand. They grow together. Faith and influence. As we grow in our faith in Jesus Christ, our influence will also grow if we're submitting to Christ and to authority. Again, Romans 13:4 and 5. For he is God's servant to do you good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword for nothing. He is God's servant, an agent of wrath to bring punishment on the wrongdoer. Therefore, it is necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also because of conscience. Living under submission is not only helpful for you to stay out of trouble, but the Apostle Paul says it's also helpful in regard to your conscience. You can actually feel better about things. Let's pray. God, you always know the crisis even before the sirens start, even before the 911 call goes in. You know the crisis that's taking place. And right now, you know what's going on. You know where that emergency vehicle is going. And Lord, I just pray that you would bring peace into that situation, whatever it is. That you would encourage those who are involved, protect those who are traveling. And God, make yourself known. Put a Jesus lover right there in the middle to show your love. In Jesus' name. Amen. Excuse me. If you think about it, the principle of submission is the primary principle on which all society is built, isn't it? Even when authority is incompetent, the principle still remains in play. The fact is, everyone must submit to authority, regardless of whether or not we feel our rights are being compromised in the process. Can you imagine what would happen if we decided, well, I don't like red lights today, so I'm not submitting to that authority. I don't like our city government, or since we don't have a state city government, I don't have to obey anything like that. I can just do what I want to on the roads. Can you imagine if we all did that? Society is built on submission to authority, the mutual willingness to do what we're supposed to be doing. And refusal to submit creates a power controversy. And who is going to get their way? You see, willingness to submit may reduce our level of power, but it will increase our level of influence. In that relationship, it will deepen our faith in God. After all, since he's the one whom we're supposed to submit to, the onus is on him to do something significantly good when we do, isn't it? Ultimately, are we not submitting to God? And so if we're submitting to God, even though, and then we're no longer going to fight that power struggle, then it's God's job to do something with that, right? Not ours. Frankly, power's overrated. And influence, submission, is very underrated in our culture. What role are you called to submit in? Spouse? Alexander's one of our few young people here today. To parents? Calvin? To mom and dad? To teachers? Who are you called to submit to? Citizens, aren't we all? Submit to the authority of our government. See, whatever the role is that you're supposed to submit in, God wants to use it to accomplish his purposes in you, to help you grow to become more like him, and to help you to be a world changer. And the fact is, we gain influence through submission. Romans 13, 6 and 7. This is also why you pay taxes. For the authorities are God's servants who give their full time to governing. Give to everyone what you owe them. If you owe taxes, pay taxes. If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honor, then honor. We can change laws, and in doing so, that might be a deterrent to crime, right? For most of you here in this room, if there was a law that said that you have to stop at every yellow light, would you do it? Most of you would do it. If the law was changed saying you got to stop at a yellow light, I got a feeling pretty much all of you would do that if that's what the law said. But generally speaking, does the law change our heart? It doesn't, does it? See, the lesson of Scripture is the law was added so that the trespass might increase. The law actually points out our guilt. The law points out our sin, Romans 5:20. In other words, people will generally follow the whims of their fallen hearts regardless of what the law says. Law just brings a sense of conformity. How many people have been smoking pot for decades? Get to my throat, sorry. How many people have been smoking pot for decades? Right here, confession, it's good for the soul. Cindy's wants to move. Just submit, Cindy. Well, the fact is I do. I know Christ followers, people who have actually been in worship here who have smoked pot for medicinal purposes, what they've said, for calming them down. They have anxiety issues and all. But the law didn't actually support them, but they were doing it. See, the law doesn't necessarily mean that we're going to conform. Only Christ can bring about a change of heart. Not the law. So the church has really got to look and say, what do we do when our rights are violated? Think about it. The early church was not committed to overthrowing Rome, were they? They weren't committed. In fact, that's one of the things that got Jesus killed. They expected a Messiah who would come and overthrow the powers that were trying to rule in Jerusalem. And since he didn't come as that kind of a Messiah, he was in the way. Even Judas tries to force him because he says, look, you know, we got to get rid of these Romans here. And Jesus, no, that's not why I've come. I have not come to set you free from Rome. I've come to set you free from judgment, sin, and guilt. I've come to give you life and to give it to you abundantly. Think about the early church. They lived in a time of slavery, didn't they? Does the Bible say that slavery was a sin? It doesn't really promote it, though, so be careful, okay? It doesn't promote slavery. Every person is of value. But in fact, what does Scripture say? It actually says, slaves, if you're a slave, really be a good one. Really do a good job. But it also didn't say, okay, I really think that you all should go out and buy people and sell people. So the Scripture is not trying to promote something. It's true Scripture, and God himself is working inside a culture to do what's most important. What's most important, be a world changer. Change the 8 to 15 people right around you. Tom Mercer said, we are Christ's followers when we follow his example and heed his instructions. We are most powerful as world changers when we joyfully live under authority. So don't fight it. Enjoy it. After all, why would you want to be in charge when you can change the world? Mercer goes on to say, the President of the United States has less opportunity to change the world than you do. Oh no, you would say, no, he's the most powerful man in the world. Well, his ego might be that. But the fact is that a world changer is more powerful than the President of the United States, because you, by the power of the Holy Spirit, can change hearts. The President we do it. See, when you live under authority, you are demonstrating faith, showing what it takes to place your livelihood into the hands of another. Essentially, what are you saying? Listen to your husband, to your wife, to your mom, to your boss, the pastor, to Caesar. You all need to place your life in submission to Jesus Christ, because you won't answer to me for whatever decisions you make on my behalf. You will answer to him. Whoever you're placing your authority under, whoever you're submitting to, you're saying, hey, I'm giving you to Jesus, and I'm trying to follow him. I said, Paul wrote these words, submit to authority, from Rome. That means he's already a prisoner. He went there as a prisoner. He's already under house arrest, and who knows, maybe it's even gotten worse by this time, where he's preparing for his death. And do you remember the Caesar, who was Caesar when he was there writing? The man's name is Nero. Nero is one of the nastiest, grossest, meanest, obnoxious, most terrible Caesars that ever ruled. He killed people to get into positions. He learned from Seneca, the philosopher, and he actually forced Seneca to commit suicide. He forced his own mother to commit suicide in order to give him more position. Nero was such a mean, nasty guy that he knew that he was losing power. Things were getting bad for him in Rome. And so what does he do? Well, it's believed that he actually set fire to Rome. In the process, more than 70% of the city was destroyed. They said that what he wanted to do was he wanted to rebuild Rome to honor himself. Now, upset because of that, what does he do? He has to find somebody to blame. And so who does he find to blame? There's this sect of weird people. They've come from Jerusalem and other places. And there's a whole group of them, and they're anarchists. And they follow this man named Jesus Christ. And let's blame them. It's the Christians that set fire. You know, they're the ones that eat people, eat flesh and blood and stuff like that. They're really bad people. They're the ones who set fire to the city. By the way, if you don't believe me, maybe you believe Tacitus, from a Roman historian from AD 60 to 120. He preserved in his record the annals, number 55.44. And so to get rid of this rumor, Nero set up, that means falsely accused, as the culprits and punished with utmost refinement of cruelty, a class hated for their abominations, who are commonly called Christians. Christus, from whom their name is derived, was executed at the hands of the procurator Pontius Pilate in the reign of Tiberius. Checked for a moment, this pernicious superstition again broke out, not only in Judea, the source of the evil, but even in Rome. Accordingly, arrest was first made of those who confessed to being Christians. Then, on their evidence, an immense multitude was convicted, not so much on the charge of arson as because of their hatred for the human race. Besides being put to death, they were made to serve as objects of amusement. They were clothed in the hides of beasts and torn to death by dogs. Others were crucified. Others set on fire to serve to illuminate the night when daylight failed. Nero had thrown open his grounds for the display and was putting on a show in the circus, where he mingled with the people in the dress of a charioteer or drove about in his chariot. All this gave rise to a feeling of pity, even towards men whose guilt merited the most exemplary punishment. Does Tacitus sound like he likes Christians? For it was felt that they were being destroyed not for the public good, but to gratify the cruelty of an individual. And who is that individual? Nero. And Paul says, submit to authority. And when he says it, he's saying, submit to Nero. And he will. And he will die. But Paul understands his purpose is to be a world changer. And ultimately what will happen? By the year 300, Caesar's household will turn to Christ. And Rome, where's the Vatican? Rome will become, quote, a Christian nation. Why? Because conversion started to happen across the Roman world. Why? Because Christians submitted. Paul himself submits to the authority of Caesar. Philippians 3. Whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ, Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. And what does he go on to say in the next chapter, chapter 4, verse 13? I can do all this through him who gives me strength. We gain influence through our submission. Even if we don't gain influence, we honor God by submitting. Why? Why submit to anyone? Because in submission, I'm becoming a world changer. And more than anything else, I want to honor God with my life. You've submitted first to Jesus. Because if you haven't, then I invite you to do it. To accept the fact that he died on the cross for you. To believe that he wants to be your Savior and to give you new life. And then to commit yourself to following him. And if you've done that, then Christian, God is calling us to submit in this world at this time in ways that will change our world for Jesus Christ.